Welcome to More Than Dentistry, where your hosts Evert and Waldo discuss life, dentistry, and everything in between with dentists around the world.
Hello, and welcome to the More Than Dentistry podcast.
Hello, and welcome today to More Than Dentistry. This is Waldo Engelbrecht, and I would also like to introduce Altus Fourie, that will also help us for myself and Evert in the future. So welcome, Altus.
Thanks, Waldo.
And today we have our guest is JP van Sail. He's one of our working colleagues and a very inspirational young guy that I think anyone can listen to.
For sure.
Thanks, Waldo. Thanks for the opportunity.
We've known each other for about, what's it now, JP?
Three years already.
Gotten along quite nicely from the beginning. And earlier, you know, JP said, you know, why me? Why interview me? You know, and I think just to state again, you know, the reason why we want to connect with the normal dentist out there is I think we can relate with each other. And we want to inspire each other. We want to share our heartaches. Like you said, this is more than dentistry. Yes. So we want to, you know, tell our stories so that we're more than just teeth. We guys that's got issues and mental issues and what we all a little bit meant for mental issues. So we've all got our things, and that's why we want to have the story as real as possible. Yeah. So that's why I want to inspire you. Just tell your story tonight, JP, because that's what it's all about. But that being said, I think JP is a guy that's done quite a lot in a short period of time. There's a drive within you, JP, that's what I want to get to, is maybe ask you, you know, like you said, Valdi, how did you get into dentistry? What inspire you to do dentistry? So let's start with that. Let's start with, you know, your story. You grew up in Transvaal, ne?
Gauteng. Yes, in the Limpopo. Okay. In a klein dorpie called Naboom Spruit. I found myself going to high school in Pretoria at Afrikaans Oorseen School, and then I eventually got the opportunity to study at Madunsa, University of Limpopo as well, and finished there round about in 2013, and then I started my community service down in Humansdorp Hospital. That was absolute fantastic
Which
experience.
Is actually quite a good hospital to do your community service.
Fantastic hospital. I'm to this day very, very humbled by the experience that I got there. You know, the colleagues that we spent time with there and the experiences that we shared was actually fantastic. And to be involved in multiple outreaches and being able to give back to the community was quite fantastic. You know, the amount of prison guards or inmates I had to deal with wasn't always as pleasant, but it was still a great experience.
So you guys, did you go to the jails and work in the jails?
Yeah,
itself?
We went to the Potensi Tronk and at Kirkwood Prison. There it's a little bit more scary.
Yeah.
But the guys from Potensi
are they
quite
in
nice.
Cuffs when you work on them?
No, there's no cuffs.
Serious? So it's like.
But in any case, so it was a fantastic experience, and you know, I decided to stay in the government sector for one more year, and just to get the time to hone your skills, and start, you know, reaching out to numerous courses, you know, different courses. I mean, that you are interested, what I was interested in, and to get the time that you actually have during government to get the time to do those type of courses and just hone your skills to a point where you feel comfortable to enter the public sector and to go out and put your stamp on what you would like to do.
So let's just go back a little bit. How did you decide to go do dentistry and not carpentry or whatever? And then how was that transition from going from public sector to private sector?
Well, I've always had a interest in the medical field, and it was always between medicine or either dentistry for me. And I spend a bit of time with a local dentist down in Jeffreys Bay. And I mean, it was fantastic to see the type of work that he was doing, and it gave me that little bit of a nudge, you know, to actually get to that point of going over into studying dentistry. Mm-hmm. And it was a difficult course, to get by, and a lot of new concepts, and you need to learn to work with your hands and different areas of dentistry to get it, under wraps. But eventually, as I got it done and got to the community service, from there, you spend a lot of time doing quite a few things, and hopefully you can do enough. And like I said, I mean, from our dental clinic down in Humansdorp, I was very fortunate to be exposed to quite a lot of different procedures. I know there's a whole lot of dentists that goes out and just goes and pulls teeth, and that's just horrible. I mean, you don't want to do that. And we were fortunate enough to do multiple procedures. And, I did quite a few implant courses during that time, and I'm, very humble to say that I actually placed one of the first implants for that hospital, in a government sector. That was
tooth implant now.
yes. And so from there to actually go over to the public sector was a big change for me. Mm-hmm. I mean, to get to a point where people start paying money to for what you did is definitely scary in the beginning. Mm-hmm. And it's great to see how you grow through the years, where you start off with giving a quote for a crown, and you're scared that this lady is not going to accept the quote, and then you get to a point where you can actually put out a quote for a full mouth rehab or what it may be, or multiple implants, and being able to accept that treatment and owning that treatment, being confident to present that is a difficult place to get to, but when you're there, to have the confidence in your skills to be able to give that back, I think is golden.
Now, what do you think gave you the confidence to get to that point? Was it the people around you? Was it just going to a bunch of courses?
I think to educate yourself to a point where you feel comfortable, where your skill level is at, and also know your limitations, first of all. and then surrounding you with peers, and mentors that will, that can assist you through this and guide you through this. Because if it's the first time you're doing something, it's quite scary. The next time you do it, it's average. And then the third time, it's everyday stuff. So to be able to have people, and I'm very fortunate to have a colleague to work with, that's actually just fantastic, and sharing his knowledge with me, and learning so much from someone like that, like previous guys also mentioned, having that mentor to assist you through this transition period, being there every day, just soaking up all the knowledge that you can to get to the point that you feel comfortable in doing that type of treatment as well.
Yeah, that's something I think Evert said that in the previous podcast, to seek experience, not money or finances initially, is a good advice to give to young guys that starting out,
Yeah, for sure.
Is in that first, you're now in doing your community service somewhere, and you're now looking, what am I going to do next year? And then to basically see where is the right guy that's doing the stuff that I want to do, and trying to get connected to those guys, instead of just taking, the first job that comes along, that's not in the practice that you want to be at, but it's a busy practice that's going to make you money. So I think that's quite challenging. I think, like you say, JP, you've been fortunate to that it's moved in that direction, that you are with somebody that's doing the stuff that you want to do.
Mm-hmm.
Which is, it's wonderful that you've come to that point, and you've come to that point quite early in your career, which is wonderful.
It's a golden opportunity, and life's about opportunities, grabbing it with both hands and doing as much as you can to embrace that opportunity.
Tell the listeners, what is your key interests at the moment?
Key interest is definitely implant surgery, together with cosmetic dentistry, and I also have a passion for facial aesthetics as well.
Mm.
So that is also a part of my everyday workflow.
Mm-hmm.
Not workflow, but everyday, patients. But, getting into surgery always makes me excited. That just puts a smile on my face. If I can, either do a wizzy or maybe a few implants in a day, it always makes the day worth it, definitely.
What about, you are the president of SADA, the Algoa Midlands. You guys have a nice team at the moment. Not so long ago, I was also part of that, but in my days, it was really a difficulty getting guys coming to meetings. It looks like things have been picking up quite well, and like the branch is now getting stronger, and I hopefully it will get stronger.
Yeah,
by the
for day. Sure. I decided to take up the reins of the president of the branch in itself, Algoa Midlands, because I felt that there was a non-existent branch, and it's a fantastic organization that we do, all of us, belong to, and they put out these different branches throughout the country so that we can get together as members and just raise our voices into difficulties that we do have or concerns that we have in the profession and what it may be. And I decided, my dad always says, rather be part of the solution than part of the problem.
Mm.
So rather than sitting back and just complaining, go there and do something about it. So we got to a point where I feel that we picked it up. I put together a very great committee of colleagues that and it's really assisting me, because you cannot do this alone. You need colleagues to assist you, and it's fantastic to see how they came to the party and really just assisting us there. So the main thing for us is to try and restore the confidence and the faith in our branch, to get the members to commit to our CPD events again, and get to a point where we can just build a community within our little Eastern Cape branch, and get everyone together. So that, because there's a lot of people struggling out there, people that's in one-man practices that just sits and doesn't have that someone to talk to, or sits with problems and he thinks he's the only guy out there. We can establish that type of community here in the Eastern Cape, and get together to take hands and make that difference. Definitely
wonderful. I agree with that. I think that community that we're talking about is you can get that community together in so many different ways. And I think in small little groups, you've got the ITI that's a little community that's forming. You've got a group practice here. You've got a few guys that study together that's also in the same city. Lots of little groups that's come together, but I don't think there's an organization that's got as many dentists as members as SADA in the country, So I think SADA's got a voice, and we need to somehow... get that strength in numbers. I'm the worst member that's out there, But, the amount of meetings that I've gone to is so little.
None of that.
Yeah. I went to that last meeting. But the thing is, I say that, but I'm not the only one that doesn't go to the meetings, and it's So you've got to ask the question, why aren't people going? What's the issues? How can we start making it an organization or a group of people that's got a voice in South Africa?
I think the big thing is momentum.
Yeah.
Is that there's for a long time there hasn't been momentum in the sense of we have meetings at this and this and designated times and that's, and then things just run dry. Is that when we have momentum with one event after the other, and not to overburden the members with stuff, then things work. And also that getting that social engagement, social media and stuff like that, that's when things do start working again.
No, that is definitely true. I mean, communicating with our members was always a big problem, you know, because it's difficult communicating via email. No one wants to have a WhatsApp group. Everyone has too many WhatsApp groups, and that's why we decided as a committee to create a Facebook page where we can communicate with the members at a much easier level, you know, and at a day-to-day basis, and you know, putting it out there. And that's why I would really like to encourage, I mean, all our Algoa Midlands SADA members to just go out, go and search for the page. Like I said, we are 130 odd members, and there's currently only 30 members on the page. I mean, there's 130 paid SADA members out there. So just get with it, and together we can just make such a big difference. It's so, so, so important. So yeah, so I'd really like to encourage everyone, come forward, you know, get to the CPD events, you as well, Altus, please attend the next one. so that we can get together, you know, you know, just build a better community for sure.
Yeah. Okay. Well, Altus will come with me, and I think this is the 31st?
31st of October,
yeah.
Yes.
No, I'll sponsor him to get there.
Listen, Waldo, we're going to move on to the more than part of this podcast.
Yep.
So I think, Waldo said earlier, before we started, he was just saying, you know, that this is a podcast that's about the industry, but it's more than that. We want to get to you as a person.
Mm.
I think a good question that you want to ask about, you know, what places, like a challenge that you've had in your life.
Yeah.
Maybe get to that.
Yeah, I always go for the soft, gooey stuff lately. So I think if there is something that you've had in the past that may have had a profound effect on how you either live your life or practice dentistry, it doesn't have to be a negative experience, it can be a positive experience, but if there's something that you think maybe took you and redirected your course to say, this is how I want to live my life.
You know, at a very, very young age, you know, I was thrown into the deep end, you know, going to the big school in the big city, and from that age, you have to, you know, get together and pull yourself together and start building yourself up to get to a point where you are stronger. Throughout, you know, all those years, you were faced with different challenges that you had to overcome. Some of it was easy, some of it was, you know, quite difficult. But through all of it, if you prevail and get to the other side, think it makes you a much stronger person, you know, getting out there and especially moving forward in life, you know, with different challenges that you faced on a day-to-day basis, going through it and being able to, you know, take the knocks that you face every day and being able to stand up and go forward. So that's quite important. There's a Afrikaans saying, you know, vasbyt.
Okay.
So there's a very nice saying in Afrikaans called vasbyt, and it's very difficult to translate that for someone, but the only way that you learn to vasbyt is to go through it, and eventually, you know, get on the other side and be triumphant. You know, recently I did my first Karoo to Coast endeavor, and it was literally the hardest thing I've ever done in my life. I mean, I'm no athlete, and I took on this 100K challenge, and I've heard that it was one of the most difficult days out there in the history.
It was raining and wind and whatnot.
Raining,
right?
And mud.
Did it hail?
There was hail hitting you, and people went to hospital for hypothermia.
Yeah, sure.
So, any case, so during that race, you know, the only thing that got you through that was vasbyt, and then also, you know, peers again, you know, surrounding yourself with people that take you further.
Yeah.
And that strengthens you in life rather than, you know, how can you say that? Rather than depending on insignificant stuff.
Mm.
Rather depending on your peers and you know, your friends to get you through that. And if it wasn't for something like that, and definitely the grace of God, I wouldn't have, you know, finish that race. So it was definitely one of the bigger achievements in my life. I don't know if I will attend the next one, but I'll definitely be out there.
It's a wonderful thing, Volley. You've also done some endurance racing, and it's a wonderful the you know, the parallels that you can draw between endurance sports and life, and how that makes you stronger in life if you've endured. So, I mean, JP and I had almost a near-death experience together where we were going to do the corporate triathlon.
Ironman.
Yeah, in Port Elizabeth. So for the people that don't know, it's like a very short, it's a tenth of the Ironman. So we now decide a week before the race, we're going to go for like a trial run in the sea. Just to swim, because I mean it's something like 380 meters of swimming in the sea. I didn't know that these transponders isn't good in the sea. So JP and I go in there, and we go through like probably three sets of waves, and I see he's turning like all white in his face, and he gets like this. I've never seen him like that before. Like, he's gonna die now.
Yeah, I think I almost died.
Yes, it was funny. So at the end we got out, but there was the thing was swimming in, there was a stream pulling you into the sea, so it went quite well. And as soon as now we decide, okay, this is now far enough that we want to turn around, you start swimming and then you stay at the same point, you know. And there wasn't other people really close by. So it was
just
a bit
one
scary.
Guy on the beach, you know, just
laughing
at us,
and
seeing
so
how
we're
busy dying.
So JP walks out and he's all pale in his face. He says to me, he's not going to do this thing anymore, you know.
There's no way.
Luckily, it was like
a beautiful day,
when the corporate triathlon was. So it was a... But it's to come back to endurance sport and what you were saying is doing these type of things that and you see that you are stronger than what you thought you were. You know, I mean, thinking, you know, I'm going to do 100Ks, and then you, while you're doing it, you think it's crazy. After usually after 20-30Ks, you think, what am I doing?
Now I'm probably hammering on the one thing, but I think we need to understand that those things that we do now in life, it's not possible if you haven't laid a foundation as a young child in your upbringing, how you handled situations. It's not everyone that can do 100 kilometers because it's not the physical capability that gets you through that. It's the mental capability that gets you through that.
And to actually get to that point and then actually realize that is to understand that you are able to do something like that. And you maybe thought that you can never do that and you did it. That in itself is a triumph.
Yeah.
How important do you think support structures are in life? I mean, you've got a very supporting wife. You've got supporting, I mean, you spoke about your dad, you know, saying you need to be part of the solution, not the problem. Now, I mean, I know your parents, the influence that they've got on your life.
100%.
Your family, you surround yourself by good people.
Yeah.
I mean, your dad, when they were down here in PE, you know, they were mentioning, they can see that they're happy with having their child here because he's got a good support structure.
Yeah.
So my question is, how important do you feel that is, and that bringing that back to giving advice to the young guy out there, surround yourself by a good support structure.
Yeah, for sure.
What's the value in that, do you think?
Yeah, get yourself friends that will be able to do that 100 kilometers with you.
Mm.
Not just the guy that's you know, partying with you every night or what it may be, but, you know, being with you through that thick and thin. You know, have a buddy that can assist you during difficult times. You know, have your wife as a support system, but surrounding yourself with friends, like-minded friends, positive friends, that will rather take you forward than set you back. And if you are confronted with a friend like that, you don't need someone like that. Put it behind you. There's another guy out there, a friend out there that wants to be that friend for you. And you can be that friend for someone as well. It's very important to invest in your friendships.
Mm.
Be the friend that you would like someone else to be to you. Otherwise, if you're not going to be that guy, you're going to stay behind. So that's super, super important. And, you know, from a dental point of view, again, getting yourself a structure and a mentor out there that you can bounce ideas off and speak with, and just, even if it's just a friend that you can just say, this happened today. I mean, a lot of times your wife or your husband doesn't understand what you went through during the day in a certain procedure, or when a root canal was difficult, or when a wisdom tooth didn't want to come out, you know, and being able to speak to a colleague and just say, listen, this happened today. And they understand because they've been there before. And you might feel that you're alone during that situation. I remember quite fondly, you know, I think it was 2 years back, I actually phoned you, Altus, the first time my first implant failed. I thought it was the end of the world. And I thought, lady's gonna sue me, I'm not gonna be able to work, probably go to prison, get AIDS and die. You know, and from that, you phoned me, and I phoned you, and you started laughing, and you said, JP, welcome to the club.
Yeah.
And that immediately just made me feel so much better.
It's just that weight off your shoulders.
It's that weight off your shoulders, you know, that you felt that it's just, I'm okay.
Yeah.
Pick up the pieces.
Yes.
And what happened, learn from that situation, and you will end up being stronger, you know, when you get out there. And then 2 years later, when someone phoned me and said, JP, my implant failed, I could do the same again.
Yes.
And give him that reassurance and say, listen, welcome to the club. It's not like we want that to happen, but I mean, we all know that there's these circumstances. But any case, to be able to have that support structure is just golden, for sure.
Tell us a little bit about what do you do except riding a bicycle for 100 kilometers in rain and hail that actually interests you.
I really love playing golf. I'm quite a keen golfer, and I've been for quite a few years. I would have loved, you know, to play a bit better than I'm currently playing. But
until
at least
you've got kids, eh?
Until you've got
then
kids.
Then you're going to think back and that you did actually play well at this stage of your life.
Yeah, so I mean, I do love playing golf. I mean, trying to play at least once or twice a month, if time persists. But other than that, during hunting season, I'm out there in the mountains, you know, looking for some kudu, or either if it's Springbok or, you know, some vlakvarkie, you know.
And you do bow hunting as well. Tell us a little bit about that.
Yes, yeah. So, I mean, and I think it was 17 years when my dad bought me a bow. And it was this, because I had this love, you know, for hunting and being out in nature, I took up the bow. And it was quite a skill to learn, you know, in the beginning. And I still think it's quite an, you know, sophisticated piece of, well, machinery. Not really machinery, but any case, you know, equipment to utilize. And it's fantastic to be out there and, you know, stalking animals like the Bushmans did, you know, and, you know, going out there and really, you know, getting the animal with the bow is the satisfaction with that is, it's much more than with the rifle. Mm. But it's still an adrenaline thrill every time you're out in the veld, you know, in the mountains. So I'm very fortunate, you know, we're in the Eastern Cape, we just have absolute fantastic, you know, hunting areas, with beautiful mountains with the fynbos and you know, the spekboom and all those type of stuff. And when you're out in the mountains sitting there, let me tell you, there's almost nothing. Your mind clears to a point where it's just fantastic. I mean, you really can relax and being out there in nature, and you can appreciate nature, is something fantastic. And so that's why I'm always looking forward to June, July, August in the year, you know, to get out there, you know, being out in nature and being able to hunt is just it's an absolute privilege, you know.
And we all need that, eh? We all need that. It's for you, it's hunting. For Everett, it's surfing or being in the ocean or flying
or running
something or whatever, running, jamming. Whatever, it's like a space that you need to get into to just almost escape from from all the rush. Of
from everyday everyday rush, for sure. Otherwise, you'll go mad. If you're constantly, you know, just hooked up on that specific case and you can't get that out and you're stressed about specific procedure or, you know, what happened there and what is going to happen there. That can occupy your mind to a point where it will just take over your life and get to a point where you don't want to, you know, you're grumpy and you don't have time for anyone else and you're just, you know, almost engulfed by your own frame of mind and to get away from that is just much better.
I think we pretty close to the end of the podcast, and so just to if you've got any call it uplifting words that you want to leave us with in regards to the young guy out there, maybe to just encourage him, words that you live by, is there any, you know, we've all got something that we live by, do you have anything that you would want to say to the guy that's starting out in dentistry? I think, you know, a lot of the times people want to get into like quite a negative space in regards to dentistry, you know, that's is there anything that you would want to say to the young guy that's starting out in dentistry, maybe to just motivate them, or words that you want to leave them with?
I think education is key. Get yourself the best education that you can, and after you're done with university, go out there and go out and do the specific and the different courses that you can just educate yourself to get to a point where you are better than what you thought you can be, and always strive to something like that, and don't be scared. I mean, all of us are scared when you first, you know, getting into private dentistry, but just don't be scared. It's something. Go out there and do the work. You'll get it eventually. And surround yourself with the right type of people that will uplift you and keep you positive and let you stay positive throughout the career. I think that's fantastic if you can have something like that.
Yeah.
for sure.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
I think the one thing that we didn't touch on was Brazil.
But oh yes, Maria. Yes, that's. I mean, we went on that course, and I just wanted to touch on that more as an icebreaker. But
yeah,
you know, I think that was quite a cool experience.
Thanks
to go and
for
do.
Sure.
I mean, we were four colleagues that went together.
Yeah.
Went there on to Ilapau,
to Curitiba at the University of Ilapau.
Yeah, Ilapau.
Yeah.
With our good friend Theo.
Theo and Willem. So that was quite a cool experience. You know, I thought back on it and just thought, yeah, how cool it is to do these things if you've got a different perspective. I think, you know, and going there, working there was such a pleasure. I mean, it wasn't
for
even
sure.
stressful to me,
no.
You know. It was such a pleasure to go and work there. And would it be an amazing thing if we could have universities, you know, almost post-university type
as a postgraduate
systems.
Well,
like
I mean,
that.
I told you when we were there, it's if we can just have that type of setup in South Africa as a postgraduate facility, you know, I do think our undergraduate facilities are fantastic. But to have a postgraduate facility that can just take you to the next level, and especially in implant dentistry, you know, having the opportunity to do the amount of things that they showed us that they are currently doing, and being able to assist the general public, you know, with that type of treatment, giving them advanced dentistry, cutting edge, you know, world class type of dentistry and implantology. Would just be fantastic. I mean, just think if you can get an investor to you know, to build a facility like that and be able to, you know, put that forward and really give that type of education to everyone out there. I mean, for someone that is, you know, starting off or what it may be, to be get the opportunity that I spoke about, opportunities and grabbing opportunities with both hands. I mean, we did definitely and you know, for yourself, I mean, we came back with so much knowledge, you know, being able to liaise with colleagues from different parts of the world, you know, guys from Amsterdam, guys from UK, you know, the guys from Luxembourg, you know, all the Portugal guys. So it's fantastic to hear how everyone else is doing it. And I really do feel that we in South Africa are very fortunate to be on the cutting edge of implant dentistry. I'm sure Ilapau will always remember Willem and Valdi because they did the first socket shield in Curitiba, Brazil. So well, for Ilapau in itself. So it's we gave them a little bit of South Africa, well, not South Africa, but I mean, we're not scared to go out there and give the type of work that we are proud to do.
Sure. Well, I think I'll give you the last word, but I just want to say thank you, JP. I think you know, you are a guy that inspire me, you know. You're a young guy, but your willingness to push and to become better at what you're doing, you're such a stand up guy. What an honor it was to podcast you, and I think, you know, like you also said, you know, I think we want to connect. So if young guys would want to connect with you, you know, that's what we want to put out there, is that you would be approachable. You'd be there for them to chat about struggles and things and ask questions about implants and things like that. So please, I'm putting the invite out for you. But, you know, connect with a guy like JP.
Yeah,
so,
for
sure.
Yeah. Give us your Instagram handle or your... you can even give your cell phone number if you want to,
your what's the thing that you have got to swipe left or right?
Your Tinder account.
Your Tinder account.
Let's not go there.
Yeah.
So yeah, you guys are more than welcome to reach out to me. I mean, you guys can get me on Facebook, Instagram, JP from Cell. I mean, that's quite easy to get, and I mean, just from there, just send me a message,
like
and we can always just start communicating. You know, that's the best thing. You know, don't feel alone out there. You know, come forward and let's discuss problems.
Yeah.
I'm definitely, I don't have all the answers, not at all. I'm still learning as we go. But I mean, you can definitely share experiences and don't feel alone out there. So no, it's great. I mean,
cool.
thanks, man. Thanks, Altus. Thanks, Valdi.
Mm.
It was really great. Thanks for coming over and so that we can have this discussion.
Yeah.
Yes.
Great. We can end off with a little song from Curitiba. So we'll see if this works. But this was Altus's favorite song.
But that song only comes out after
what, a few caperinas.
Caperinas.
Sound a car from Santana in the GMB. Ghetto blues from the refugee.
Oh, Maria, Maria.
That was the only part of the song that we listened to in Curitiba. But anyway,
only words I could remember was Maria, Maria.
Okay, thanks, guys.
Right, cheers.
Thank you.
Thank you.